Check.
Okay, keep me posted. Be careful.
Copy that. Will do. KS7TXE clear. Right here, they cut this fence down. Cut it off. There's a road that goes all the way down to the gas pipe roads, and they brought in one vehicle that was very, very heavy. Obviously not drugs. I mean, they throw drugs over the top all the time. So for them to go to all of that work, you know, it worries you what was in that vehicle that they couldn't launch over the top. And the first thing I think of is weapons or, you know, some sort of a weapon that, you know, anything that would be very, very heavy would probably be uranium-based or something of that nature. So that's, you know, they were successful in doing it and only did it once. You know, they probably won't try it in this area again. The connections are tight. If it's still distorted, then it's a power supply.
It seems to get a little better. It's actually a lot better, but there's still a little bit of movement through there, but it is better.
Okay, good. I'm going to anchor down the wire. Is it level? Is it sitting level and looking at the back of the Jeep right now?
No, it needs to, whoa. Yeah.
Okay, is it clear?
Yeah, I think it's pretty clear.
Okay, good enough, thank you. This one looks down the side of the house. It gets down the side of the house and out into the yard. This one looks down my fence line back towards the back. And then there's another one there that looks out into the field to my east. Okay, the camera that is looking across the porch, you see it?
Yep, looks good. Clarabel looks good.
Clarabel, do you look good on camera?
She agrees, she looks good on camera. Don't you, girl? The dog and the cat don't realize they're on camera, and the dog hates the cat whenever we're around, but whenever we're not around, they're the best of friends. Oh, you and the cat, oh.
Yes.
Okay, you see what camera I'm at right now?
Yes.
Okay, double click on this.
Yeah, and I think it's pretty clear.
Before this big wall, before that was up, we've had them bring down the INS bus, 60 people at a time in my pasture, 60 people wandering around. And they themselves were only just the standard illegal. They weren't up to no good. They wanted to get over here for a better job, which doesn't exist. They're just told that. That's a myth. But that's what they're here for. They don't mean us any harm. You know, I'm not scared of them, you know, like that. But 60 people, they leave a lot of garbage. They have to change their clothes. They have to get out of the clothes that they came over the border with. They've got more clothes with them. Well, this is disgusting, and it's the truth. It's the truth, and it's a fact, and I don't know how people watching this will take it. I don't know if you will want to edit this out. It's because they smell. It's their smell. a group of them can walk by, can walk right through here. And if I come through here in 10, 5, 10, maybe even 15 minutes, I can still smell them, the lingering odor. They have to change that. You'll see an awful lot of perfumes. Axe is real popular. Axe body sprays, deodorants and things like that, an awful lot. So so then, you have, of course, then you have the Mexican national. They smell one way. Other than Mexicans, particularly Middle Easterns, because of their diet, smell just as bad, just as strong, but they're different. So you can pick up on they're other than Mexicans. They call them OTMs. And then, or MEs, Middle Easterns. You have Mexican nationals, you have OTMs, and then you have MEs. And you can sure pick up on that smell. Like I say, it's kind of disgusting, but it is what it is. You know what we smell like to them? A hamburger. A lot of people in other countries will say Americans smell like hamburgers.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, I was related to almost everybody down here. Virtually everybody down here I was related to. But more people are moving in, and they're not overly friendly to us, Usans types. I wave at them, and they look at me like, what's your problem? Next to our beds, we do keep weapons. My wife is small. On her side of the bed is a Ruger. She has a small hand, so she uses a very small weapon. It's a 380. We do have it currently loaded with body armor piercing bullets. So, you know, it's a very effective weapon, very deadly weapon. And we use the lasers on the things so that you don't have to point. As you can see, you know, all you have to do is put your hand around the gun. The laser light comes on, that's where the bullet's gonna go to. So that assists you at night. If I've got the same thing on my Glock, instead of having to take aim, you know, and actually having to take aim, they see the red dot on them, they know that you mean business. The next thing that's gonna happen is the bullet's gonna hit right where that dot is. On my side of the bed over here, my hand is considerably bigger, and I like a Ruger. The holster is one that you have to, that locks, riding the quads, etc. You know, the gun won't come out. This gun would be devastating to you. Like I say, we've got these here, and I would hate to have to come out of a sleep to use one. I don't live in fear, but you live aware. You know, when you do step to the back door, you always look all the way around. We seldom go outside without weapons. On my telephone, I have the FBI Cochise County Sheriff's Department, NSA, Border Patrol, Bisbee Police Department, everybody's on speed dial. If the dogs of the neighborhood are too quiet, you also have too quiet. So, you know, just feelings. It's not paranoia, it's just kind of a way of life.
If you're carrying an M16 rifle with a plastic stock and you make that plastic noise, there's nothing down in that canyon but an M16 rifle is going to make that noise. So if they're going to hear that and they're going to know who that is, and they're going to go in the other direction. So there's a whole lot about equipment, about technique, about operations, about how you do things that are important for officer safety, because you want that person to not know where you're at any point in time. Now, if you see the guy driving down the road, that's one thing. But if he's out on foot where he's vulnerable, more vulnerable, don't want to disclose your location until you're close enough to touch him. And that's the bad thing about Border Patrol, is seeing these people doesn't mean anything. To actually apprehend them, you have to get close enough to put your hands on them. That's the difference between Border Patrol and the military. The military can sit back 3 miles away and pull a cord and shoot a shell or call in an airstrike and take care of their problem. We have to actually get close enough to put our hand on them. That's where the art form comes in. That's where the difficulty comes in. That's where it takes the experience, because you have to do that safely. Camera pole. Watch the camera pole right there on top of that hill. Right over there is where Alex Kerpnick, one of my agents, was killed back in 1998. Shot right there.
by a drug smuggler. Bullet came out the back of his head. He hesitated. When the guns come out, you can't hesitate. You have to do what you gotta do. You've got all this country up in those mountains where nobody lives. It's all national forest, and they tried to make it a wilderness area. And as soon as they started limiting access, the criminals went in there and started taking over and really made it a very dangerous place. Probably the most dangerous place on the border right now. This is the border. This is what you've got to deal with right here. And you have to deal with it in the rain, the snow, the heat, at night, whatever happens.
Years ago, there wasn't any problem because of the border. And then the immigration problem started, and then they started cutting fences, and then the Border Patrol came, and then they start chasing everybody. And so they tear up just as much as the illegals tear up. And so, anyway, that's what affects ranching, is there's always something going on the ranch with people or vehicles being chased. It's as much Border Patrol as it is illegals. In the 80s, it started increasing. In the 90s, it goes from 10 or 20 a month to 20 a day. And then in the late 90s, it's a couple of hundred a day. And in the early 2000s, it's 200 or 300 a day. And then about in probably 2009, the big groups stopped. And it'd be 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 maybe. But there was, they weren't, you could tell they're not a good class of people. And they didn't want to come work here. They're coming as criminals, and they're coming to Phoenix or wherever. And they're involved in the drugs and the cartel and smuggling people. And so then they're going back and forth. The illegal numbers is way down. We still got them. But the drugs, 3 or 4 times a week that they're coming through. So you tell me, we got a 13-foot wall, we got a 10-foot wall, and they're driving trucks through them, and nobody can catch them. You got 4 cameras on the ranch. You've seen the big towers and all that. Nobody sees them, nobody knows about it, nobody catches them.
The way you look at it, first of all, as you're going along the fence, you look and see where people have crossed. Then you look down here on the ground and see if the footprints are fresh. And you can see here where the fingerprints are on this side of the pole. That means they climbed up from the Mexican side and came over. If they had climbed up from this side, the handprints would be on the other side. Like here. You can see the footprints here where they went back over the fence. But if you look on the other side, their handprints will be on the other side. So you see people going in both directions here. And what they do is they knock the rust off. But the way you tell how old it is by look at the footprints here where they come off of the fence. So when you think of the criminal activity that is associated with illegal immigration, it is marijuana, cocaine, methamphetamine, and heroin. It's money. All of this stuff is produced in another country, is brought to this border and brought across this border and then distributed throughout the United States for sale. If it doesn't make it across the border, it can't be sold. The other problem is getting the money from the sale back to the people that own the drugs. So there's a lot of money to be made inside the United States in that exchange, because it's very difficult to handle cash. And they don't accept anything but cash. So you have to have a corrupted institution or institutions inside the United States that allows that to happen at that level, in that magnitude, for that amount of money to be collected, distributed, condensed to where it's hidden in plain sight, and go back to the people that own the drugs. They had visual aerial surveillance on 7,333 aliens that came across the border west of here, of which the Border Patrol caught 410. Is that a secure border? No. If they had 410 get away out of 7,333, you're getting closer to secure border. A really secure border is where nobody even tries to come across. And I am certain that that is not what the people in Washington, D.C. want.
The people coming, whether it's Mexican, Guatemalan, anybody, Central America, they're coming here and they're working for half of what Americans work for. The corporations that hire them don't pay taxes, it's cash, half of what they pay an American. That's why it's still happening, in my opinion. You know, I've said the Republican Party wants cheap labor. The Democrats want cheap votes. The American people want cheap tomatoes. Well, up until 1990, there was no road up here, and there was no streetlights, no wall. It was a barbed wire fence for the boundary between the two countries. But this road didn't go all the way through. Our cows went right up to the boundary fence. America thinks that every Mexican's a bad person. But not every Mexican's bad. Not every Mexican's selling dope. Not every one of them's coming here illegally. And that's ruined part of the relationship with them. We crossed all the time. Help each other round up cows. Go up to the mountain. Go to restaurants. Go across the line to drink. Party. No more. Because of the wall.
It's very otherworldly. I mean, you see it in movies all the time that you think are just stupid, weird movies, but here you are, you live it. You know you're being watched. If you live here, you know it. Sadly, a lot of people have gotten used to it. I don't think we should. And it's our right to be able to come out on public lands to camp and be private and be quiet and not be interfered with, but they'll sit in their cars, the Border Patrol sit up on the mountainside and watch you camping, and we'll watch them watching us, and you've got the towers, you know, are always watching you. It's very creepy if you stop and think about it. It's like you're never really alone. This is Big Brother. This is our backyard. This is a station that the Border Patrol or Homeland Security has, one of many that are out here in the desert. They're supposed to be protecting us from what, I don't know. They are not allowed to be pointed into Mexico, who supposedly we're in fear of. They point instead into our desert and our town site. They can radio between tower to tower and pinpoint where people are and how many people there are and radio in to get boots on the ground, as they say, to come marching up on you with their AK-57s at any moment. There's buried sensors out here. You trip without even knowing it, and you get come down on once again with guns, horses, ATVs, whatever they happen to be on at the time. And it's like, for instance, the mountain over here is Baba Kibri. That is a holy mountain to the Native Americans. And to me, this is the holy mountain to money right here. I think it would upset anybody that you live in the United States and you can't take a child to school without going through a border checkpoint daily. They'll pull you over to the side. They want to search your car. They want to search your trunk. They want to look under your car. They ask you where you're going, where you're coming from. And legally, the only thing they can ask you is, are you a U.S. citizen? But they don't stop there. It's a daily, daily thing. And these poor kids, they go to school in a militarized zone. Hard to teach them any trust because the outside world is constantly fear, fear, fear. How does a child learn love and trust and humanity from that? Let's get you around to the side, okay? This war at the border is a war on us. It's not a war at the border. They've locked us down in this country, and they're locking us down harder and harder all the time. But it hit this country to a point where our government was able to take our rights away from us under the guise of protecting us. And it turned these border issues into a war against us. And I can't see going through my life in fear of my neighbor.
Hola, somos amigos. Tenemos agua, comida. Ayúdale. Los problemas médicos. Somos amigos. Okay. I don't know. Over there, that tree. Yeah, I think over here. It's a little bit.
Yeah, I think it's better because this is more of a. Okay. Yeah, so
a few years ago, late at night, maybe around midnight, a young couple showed up at our back gate, freezing. They were well underdressed, who knows how long in the desert. It was way below freezing, probably around 20 degrees. And they had their two young children, probably maybe 2 years old and 4 years old with them. So, and I really wasn't sure what to do. And in, you know, I got them blankets, coats, hats, and did all these other things, but I didn't bring them in the house. And even at that point, I wasn't real clear on the legal aspects of helping people that were, you know, traveling through the area. You know, looking back, I can say, well, I could have brought him in. It would have been no problem. Today, I would do that. But I look back now, you know, I gave him all this great stuff, but then I sent them on their way. Morally, I knew at that point that's what I should have done. And it shouldn't have mattered. You know, what was wrong with me? I can do better than that. If you put yourself in their position, they're leaving their homes, they're leaving their families, their extended families, their whole culture, giving that all away and taking this tremendous risk to cross this unknown territory to enter another country. And you think they'd do that on a whim? I mean, this must be the most difficult decision they ever make in their lives. When people speak of this lightly and act as if these people are somehow invading this country on some sort of, you know, oh, well, you know what, let's just take off and go to the United States today. You know, put yourself in their position. You know, how would you feel?
About 5 years ago now, Gina and her husband, Junior, were at home with one of their daughters, Brisenia, and they had finished dinner and gone to bed, and they heard somebody pounding on the door, and Junior came to the door, and it was the first people he saw were two men saying that they were Border Patrol, and they were wearing uniforms like Border Patrol and had their sidearms on, and said they were in hot pursuit of some illegals, like they like to say, and they needed to come in and search the house. And Junior got to looking at them, and he saw one of the guns was electrical tape wrapped on the handle. And he said, well, that's kind of a funny gun for Border Patrol to be carrying around. And they pulled the guns out, and they shot him. And his daughter was standing right there, Brisenia, she was 9. And she started crying, and they told her to shut up, and of course, she just saw you shoot her father, you know. So they shot her in the face and killed her. But it came out that it was this militia group, which out here on the border, there's several different groups, but they're all militia type groups. They wear uniforms to try and look like they're military, Border Patrol, whatever. They come out, you know, oh, we're going to protect our border and we're guarding the United States and we're wonderful, wonderful people. They always hassle the locals, give us a hard time, saying that we're just, you know, we're not good Americans because we're not guarding our border from these poor, destitute, starving people coming across. if you go back in history and look back, any time mankind has drawn a line and said, this is my side, this is your side, made an imaginary line in the sand and called it a border, it's caused trouble. It still does to this day. To say this is my side and you can't cross, and this is your side and I can't cross, and it's all imaginary.
Inside this brush here is a creek bed, and they use it to hide while they're waiting to be picked up. You can walk up through some of these little paths coming out of there, and sometimes if you're lucky, you can find somebody hiding in there, but they may not be happy to see you. The death rate here in the summertime is tremendous. I mean, it's in the thousands every year along the entire border. And in the last year or so, we've seen more cases where if somebody can't keep up anymore, they'll come back and take their food and water so they can give it to the people that still can walk. And so it makes their chances of survival very, very small at that point. And there are a lot of bodies out here in the desert. And, the coyotes and the buzzards take care of a lot of them. I don't know if you saw the buzzards when you came in, but the buzzards in this area are more numerous, and they're fatter, and they reproduce faster because they have a lot more to eat in along these areas.
We're not kids anymore, you know. A lot of us are retired, and we spend time in the desert, and sometimes we'll come out 3, 4, and 5 days and stay out here. People in the United States, and we speak for a lot of people, they're very, very angry about the fact that these people here are coming into our country. We have no idea who they are. We have no idea what their background is. And those people should be sent back. They're not the kind of people that builds a country. They're the kind of people that lives off a country that's being built. They're all over the United States. They're your new neighbors. See some pretty fresh footprints here. They come down off of here. Well, it's within the last couple days. You can see here where this. That's what they carry now, the black water bottles.
He and I are both veterans of the Vietnam War, so the first time I came out on an operation like this, I felt like I knew exactly what was going on, and basically I had been trained for this exact process. So in effect, I was just trying to get a little bit more mileage out of that training that the United States Army was so generous to give me.
So generous. This is not a good place to be. Not a good place to be. You never know when things can turn bad and sour, and this place always has a potential of doing that. This was not here last time, but it's pretty putrid. But it wasn't here last time. You can't go out in this desert in an area that's active with drug and illegals and be passive. You've got to be always on the alert, always ready.
Notice there's a double fence right here. And as we get out here, it becomes pretty small. Now, see how small the fence is here? Now, it was in this area where they put the National Guard over here, but they didn't stay very long. And they would fly around, take pictures of where they were, come back every so often, and they would be gone. Most of that was just for show. They'd drive around, the media would come out, take pictures, say, hey, the National Guard is on board. And once they got their pictures, they all left.
Want to get this one in the set, do you think?
Yeah.
All right. See, one, two. Yeah, that's good. Let me see if I can get a picture of this thing. Hey, that's great. We'll put this up on the internet. That's pretty nice. It's not racist to say I want to protect my border. We don't know who's crossing the border. We don't know if they have bombs or they're murderers or anything else. That's why we have borders, to control that sort of thing. When they say the border is secure, that's insanity. It is out of control. So what we will do is fly over there, and then when we hear the report, we will know, and they give the location. We will fly right over it and take video of what was going on. ABP? This is very interesting. We had our sensors out in the river, okay? And our sensors were triggered, and we actually moved into position with our camera, and this is what we saw.
Yeah, I cut a group of cars. I'm trying to get a tally, total number here for you. But you said no one cut this yesterday, correct?
We're going to need an EMS at the KT turnoff on 86.
Here's another one where the guys, they're walking along. when they see us. Oh, what's that? Bunch of stupid gringos, right?
So what?
They don't know who we are. They don't know if we've got weapons. So what do? Do they turn around and run back? No. They keep going. Every time. They're not afraid of what might happen to them. Because we are very kind people, okay? We don't hurt anybody. So they know, and I've seen this over and over again. Now, if you were to do this in the Soviet Union, or if you were to be sneaking into Iraq or Iran, let's say, you would be frightened to death, wouldn't you? If you're sneaking into the United States, this is the way they behave. Because they know nothing bad is going to happen to them. We're very soft people, very kind people. And that is known by the people who come in here. They know that. They're not going to be hurt. We won't shoot them. We won't hurt them. So they're not afraid. And I think that's an interesting lesson, isn't it? George loves these chickens. He sits by hour, watches them. Starlet likes them too. If we didn't have this fence, if we didn't have a border, how many people do you think would come here from Bangladesh? Millions. How many people would come here from all over the world? This is where they want to come. So we would be overwhelmed, and it would stabilize, except when instead of everybody rising, we would all fall to the same level, in my judgment. I think we are the last best hope of the universe, you know. We listen in the dark night sky for signals coming from other planets. We hear nothing. We hear nothing. We may be all alone. And if we're all alone, and this is the finest nation in the world in terms of freedoms and the principles upon which it built, am I standing here as the sole guy in the whole galaxy trying to save the future of the human race? Maybe I am. Wouldn't that be funny? That would be strange. George! George, no dig! I got the rock! I got it! We know how to fly to Mars. We can go to moons 40 years ago. We can do all of these things, okay? But we can't secure this line on the border. This is madness. Absolute, utter madness. It's sanity.
You can see almost all of these are migrant remains. So you can see that the number is 2013. That means calendar year 2013. And then our case number is 990. If we take another example down below, here we have 2013 case 750. And then they have Doe written on there. So you can say it's a John Doe if you know it's a male, or a Jane Doe if you know if it's a female, or if we haven't sorted it out yet, typically we'll just write Doe on there. Question? What is that thing there?
That would be a bone from an animal that's not a human.
Here we go. I feel better. Thank you very much. Which animal?
Oh, it's not human.
Okay.
Probably a deer. Maybe a cow. Probably okay. A deer. Yeah, they're all puzzles, right? There's about 200 bones in the adult skeleton, and when they're broken, there's even more. We don't have them all. But it's a puzzle we've seen before. It's a very recognizable puzzle. It's got enough pieces, like a jigsaw puzzle. It's got enough pieces for us to get a real good idea of what he looked like in life. So we know it's a male, we know he's an adult. Been to a dentist. Lost some teeth. Probably made it to his 30th birthday, but maybe just a few years younger. Looks to have some degree of Native American ancestry, so either American Indian or Hispanic. He's not exceptionally tall. I can tell from those two thigh bones. So he is a very average, based on the 2,100 bodies and skeletons we've gotten in this office for the last 13 years. He would be very typical of hundreds and hundreds of young men, both identified and unidentified, that have come through this office in the last 13 years. Well, he's a person, you know. We all have mothers, fathers. Most of us have sisters, brothers. Some of us have children. He's got some of those same relatives. And those relatives haven't seen him probably for 1 or 2 years. And they probably don't know what happened to him. Unless they were with him when he died. And they know he's dead, but his body was left in the desert. They don't know. So you compound the misery and agony in a family of A, not having that person there and not knowing if they're alive or dead or imprisoned or suffering or even had their bodies been found yet. So that's why we do what we do.
Here is 2013 is case number 49, so it's probably from January of this year. Here we just used a piece of tape to lay out the pesos. Here we have an identification again from Mexico. Here's a photograph of a girl labeled 2006. I don't know if this is a sister or a daughter or a relative some fashion. There was a cell phone in this pouch, and it looks like it was, this basically says RLS, which means released to Mexcon, MXCon, so it was released to the Mexican consulate. So for them to look for numbers to use for the cell phone. Here we have a condom that's not going to be effective anymore. It's kind of fun to try to identify people. Not that you want to have to be in that position, but at least it's gratifying when you do, when you are able to identify someone.
If you can't let people stand in line and pay a fee in a timely manner, they're going to sneak across. I would do it. You would probably do it. People do it all over the globe, right? All over the globe, international boundaries get infringed upon by other people, typically those people that are going to do lower-paying blue-collar jobs. So my feeling is that we should let these people in to do those jobs, or we should keep them out of Arizona. But right now, we don't do either. We make it hard for them to come here legally. And at least in southern Arizona, away from the urban areas, we allow them to get into our desert. Some of them die, some of them make it to their destination. So, what are you going to do? until the politicians pass new laws, regulations, we're going to see more of this.
Check.
Okay, keep me posted. Be careful.
Copy that, will do. KS7TXE clear. Right here, they cut this fence down. Cut it off. There's a road that goes all the way down to the gas pipe roads, and they brought in one vehicle that was very, very heavy. Obviously not drugs. I mean, they throw drugs over the top all the time. So for them to go to all of that work, you know, it worries you what was in that vehicle that they couldn't launch over the top. And the first thing I think of is weapons or, you know, some sort of a weapon that, you know, anything that'd be very, very heavy would probably be uranium-based or something of that nature. So that's, you know, they were successful in doing it and only did it once. You know, they probably won't try it in this area again. The connections are tight. If it's still distorted, then it's a power supply.
It seems to get a little better. It's actually a lot better, but there's still a little bit of movement through there, but it is better.
Okay, good. I'm going to anchor down the wire. Is it level? Is it sitting level and looking at the back of the Jeep right now?
No, it needs to, oh, yeah.
Okay, is it clear?
Yeah, I think it's pretty clear.
Okay, good enough, thank you. This one looks down the side of the house. It gets down the side of the house and out into the yard. This one looks down my fence line back towards the back. And then there's another one there that looks out into the field to my east. Okay, the camera that is looking across the porch, you see it?
Yep, looks good. Clarabelle looks good.
Clarabelle, do you look good on camera?
She agrees, she looks good on camera. Don't you, girl? The dog and the cat don't realize they're on camera, and the dog hates the cat whenever we're around, but whenever we're not around, they're the best of friends. Oh, you and the cat, oh.
You got it?
Yes.
double click on him.
Yeah, and I think it's pretty clear.
Before this big wall, before that was up, we've had them bring down the INS bus, 60 people at a time in my pasture, 60 people wandering around. And they themselves were only just the standard illegal. They weren't up to no good. They wanted to get over here for a better job, which doesn't exist. They're just told that. That's a myth. But that's what they're here for. They don't mean us any harm. You know, I'm not scared of them, you know, like that. But 60 people, they leave a lot of garbage. They have to change their clothes. They have to get out of the clothes that they came over the border with. They've got more clothes with them. Well, this is disgusting, and it's the truth. It's the truth, and it's a fact, and I don't know how people watching this will take it. I don't know if you all will want to edit this out. It's because they smell. It's their smell. A group of them can walk by, can walk right through here. And if I come through here in 10, 5, 10, maybe even 15 minutes, I can still smell them, the lingering odor. They have to change that. You'll see an awful lot of perfumes. Axe is real popular. Axe body sprays, deodorants and things like that, an awful lot. So so then, you have the Mexican national. They smell one way. Other than Mexicans, particularly Middle Easterns, because of their diet, smell just as bad, just as strong, but they're different. So you can pick up on they're other than Mexicans. They call them OTMs, and then or MEs, Middle Easterns. You have Mexican nationals, you have OTMs, and then you have MEs. And you can sure pick up on that smell. Like I say, it's kind of disgusting, but it is what it is. You know what we smell like to them? A hamburger. A lot of people in other countries will say Americans smell like hamburgers.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, I was related to almost everybody down here. Virtually everybody down here I was related to. But more people are moving in, and they're not overly friendly. Us types. I wave at them and they look at me like, what's your problem? Next to our beds, we do keep weapons. My wife is small. On her side of the bed is a Ruger. She has a small hand, so she uses a very small weapon. It's a 380. We do have it currently loaded with body armor piercing bullets. So, you know, it's a very effective weapon, very deadly weapon. And we use the lasers on the things so that you don't have to point. As you can see, you know, you all you have to do is put your hand around the gun. The laser light comes on. That's where the bullet's going to go to. So that assists you at night. If I've got the same thing on my Glock, instead of having to take aim, you know, and actually having to take aim, they see the red dot on them. They know that you mean business. The next thing that's gonna happen is the bullet's gonna hit right where that dot is. On my side of the bed over here, my hand is considerably bigger.
and I like a Ruger. The holster is one that you have to, that locks, riding the quads, et cetera, you know. The gun won't come out. This gun would be devastating to you. Like I say, we've got these here, and I would hate to have to come out of a sleep to use one. I don't live in fear, but you live aware. You know, when you do step to the back door, you always look all the way around. We seldom go outside without weapons. On my telephone, I have the FBI, Cochise County Sheriff's Department, NSA, Border Patrol, Bisbee Police Department, everybody's on speed dial. If the dogs of the neighborhood are too quiet, you also have too quiet. So, you know, just feelings. It's not paranoia. It's just kind of a way of life.